I'm Tom Crouser, and welcome to this short tutorial on where do we get the prices that go into the Crouser guides in the first place. So, let's get started. The first place we get our data is from our own panel on prices, wages, and costs, and we invite you to participate. Go to Crouser.com and click to join. You'll receive invitations to join specific surveys, and you're free to pick and choose the ones that pertain to you. Those who do participate receive back a full report on how their data matches up to everyone else, and there's no cost or obligation. So that's the first place we get our data. The second place is that we hunt for and collect published price lists. And the third place is we utilize any and all industry and government studies that pertain. Then we get to make sense of what we have. For it's extremely important that your price plan be fair and rational. It needs to be fair to you and your customer, and it has to be something that both of you can easily understand. For instance, let's say you sold dresses, and it was your policy to double the cost on all dresses that cost less than $100 to arrive at a selling price. But it was also your policy to mark up dresses costing more than $100 by 1.5. So if a dress costing $99 increases to 101, the price goes down from 198 to 151. And that doesn't make sense to anyone, to you or your customer. So how does this apply to printing? Well, anytime we use a price grid and apply the total number of impressions by a decreasing value, you'll have a fault line where a higher volume will cost less than a lower volume. Now, take your current price list grid and then multiply the number of originals by the number of copies by the price per copy to get the total cost the customer pays. Ta-da! Fault lines. Mathematically, they have to be there anytime you apply a decreasing price to all previous units as well as the new ones. And here's how we avoid it in the Crouser guides. We use a build process. Start with 5 images costing 20 cents. Okay, that's a dollar each. Then add 5 more costing 15 cents. In our case, that's 5 times 15 added to the previous dollar for $1.75. But notice how the grid method applies the 15 cents to all 10 copies and not just the incremental 5, yielding $1.50. Now, let's add 5 more at 9 cents and pow, there's your fault line. In our method, you can't have a fault line on length of run because you're adding to the previous number. In the grid method, you will always find fault lines, so we have to take them out of the data for you. Now here's an easy way for you to put the Crouser guide information into your software's estimating grid, however. Go to a specific price page and find the price, and then just divide the price by the length of run, and you have your specific grid price to enter. Okay, now say you had the prices from 10 of your competitors or something, and the average was $19.95, just like you would find in a survey result. Well, now say the customer wants to use more expensive paper or less expensive paper. How do you adjust for paper costs? We work hard to develop a correlation between surveyed prices and cost of paper so that you may recapture the cost of more expensive paper in your prices, as well as make adjustments for production methods. Maximum size production takes longer than smaller sheet sizes. Heavier stock takes more time than lighter stock. These are but a few of the examples of the adjustments that we make to raw survey data so that your price plan will not only be fair, but rational to you and your customer. Okay, let's talk about what we mean by price. What if we surveyed the sticker price of automobiles? Would the results be what you would expect to pay? Or would you expect to pay something else? There are all sorts of prices. Initial offering price, for instance, or the initial offer the seller receives from a potential buyer. There are static prices, $1 for an apple, for instance, or dynamic prices, such as 500 apples for 50 cents each, 1,000 for 25. But what we usually mean by price is the concept of clearing price. That's the price that allows me to sell all of my production at the highest value without really having to deal with anyone. Now, that's not realistic because the clearing price is the result of negotiation. And if you are negotiating, your fair and rational price plan is the starting place. You would never start at your lowest price because your final price will always be lower than that. So your price plan has to be fair and rational to you and your customer. So we deal with this price first, and if you make a deal off the list price, well, then you have room to do so. Okay, what's the goal again? A rational and fair price plan that you can understand, your customers can understand, and most importantly, your people can understand because they are the one to have to administer the plan. If they don't or can't, then you are the person who ends up dealing with price with each and every customer. And if you do that, you don't have a price plan. You just spend all your time pricing and negotiating with customers. So it's important that it be easy to administer. But here's another important reason to have a price plan that's easy to administer, and that is speed. We've seen studies in printing companies concluding the faster you get a price to a customer, the more likely you are to close the sale. Get the price back to them today and you close 6 sales. But if you wait until tomorrow, you only close 2 of the 6. And may the force be with you if you don't get the prices back for a week or so. Now, how do we analyze the data on your behalf? Let's say we have all the specific prices on a job. Here are 44 prices. Now, these aren't bid prices, but they're like sticker prices. The list price of a specific item from 44 of your competitors. Now, the average is $14.03, the highest is $21, and the lowest is $8. So what's your strategy? Where do you put your list price to get the most business? Well, the answer is you don't have enough information because you're just looking at the extremes and not the meaningful ranges of prices. Okay, let's look at these prices another way. Let's stack them up from the lowest price or minimum to the highest price or maximum. And to make it easy, let's say we have 100 prices total now. To find the meaningful or relative range of the prices, count up to the 25th price or the 25th percentile. That's the meaningful lower range price. Then continue up to the 50th price. That's the meaningful mid-range. And then up to the 75th price or 75th percentile, and that's the meaningful high range price. What we are doing is analyzing the data through the use of an array instead of a normal distribution statistics. So why would we do that? Well, because the array is more accurate when there are fewer data points, not enough to make a normal distribution curve. You know, the old bell-shaped curve they talked about in school. It's like when you do a price survey among your competitors. Those prices are all over the place, so follow me on this method and you might want to use it to make sense of what you're doing. Let's take these same numbers and then lay them on their side and put them in brackets. To the far left, the first column indicates that 2% of the prices came in between $8 and $9, and at the far right, you can see that 5% of the prices were $20 or more. So here's the minimum, $8, and here's the maximum, $21, and here's the average, $14.03. Do you see why you don't have enough information to make an informed decision with just those 3 points? All you're looking at are the extremes. That's not enough info to establish a fair and rational price plan. Now, compare that with the method we're using, the percentiles among the quartiles. Let's find the 25th percentile point and the 75th percentile, as well as the 50th percentile. See how that captures the bulk of the meaningful numbers? This is the meaningful range, and it's best descriptive of our total market. So we work hard at defining the relative range of data, and this specifically is where our X or low book is aimed, along with our Y or middle book, and Z, the high book. For instance, you could see prices like this, $11.50 in the low book and $15.75 in the high. Important thing here is that they are not a specific percentage of each other. They are based on the percentiles at that particular point, the prices at that particular point. If you have not yet reviewed the tutorial on the role price plays in our success, then I'd suggest you do so. In it, we explained that while there are literally hundreds of printers, we only deal with 4 or 5 competitors in any one account, and that's because the customer wants it this way. Customers don't have time to get prices from 40 or 50 printers every time they have a job. They have real work to do. Rather, they develop relationships with a few trusted printers, and your competition is among them. Again, click review the role price plays in our success for complete information. Now see if this makes sense to you. Here's the price range from lowest to highest. If you adopt a low price strategy, your prices will tend to be below 75% of others, but still higher than 24%. So your low price strategy doesn't meet the lowest of the low, and that's because you're not competing with everyone in every account. Same with a middle of the road price plan and with a high price strategy. Here you're higher than 74% of the others, but still lower than 25%. And that's because these are price strategies. These aren't just about being the lowest or the highest price. And using the Crouser guide, you can implement a low, middle, or high price strategy with a quick flick of the drop-down menu. Flick from any price level to another in less than a second, so it's easy for you to compare price levels when you're in those competitive situations. And because our guides are software-based, they can be updated via the internet throughout the year. And by the way, the software resides on your computer, not on the internet. We just use that for support and updates, and you can put it on all of your PCs without additional cost or obligation. Oh yes, someone always asks, how come we don't print out all this in a manual or a book? Well, our digital printing price guide, for instance, would have over 13,000 pages, and it'd be hard for you to find anything. Using the software, we can flick from one to another almost instantaneously. Our goal is to provide you with usable and actionable price information, to translate survey and marketing data into something you can use. We see you typically putting this into your print shop estimating software, regardless of what you use, whether it's PrintSmith or something else. However, some will use our guide for specific prices, so that's why we've added features such as the one-click capture of prices to make it easier for you to paste prices into other applications. But this guide isn't a substitution for estimating software. Estimating software has many downstream advantages, such as when you're redoing jobs or in the area of accounts receivable. Nonetheless, our job is to provide you with usable and actionable prices that are fair and reasonable to you and your customer, as well as your staff, so they can quickly administer the price. The question was, where did we get the prices in the first place? Well, the answer is we start with our panel on prices, wages, and costs. Then we find any and all other industry and government information available, and then we construct a fair and rational price plan that's easy for you to administer. I'm Tom Crouser, and thank you for listening.